Let me say some words in Greek first. Κύριε Πρόεδρε, κύριε Γενική Γραμματέα, κύριε Πρώην Υπουργέ Δημοσίας Τάξεως, κύριε Πανούση, καθώς είστε πίσω τον καιρό, γίνεσαι από τους πρώτους που ξεκίνησαν όλα αυτά που οδηγούν σήμερα στο να λένε ότι η Ελλάδα είναι στην πρώτη γραμμή των διεθνών πρωτοβουλίων για ασφάλεια σας. Ευχαριστώ γι' αυτό. Κύριε Πρέσβης, κύριε εκπρόσωπο των Ενόπλων Δυνάμεων, του Σωμάτων Ασφαλείας, κυρίες και κύριοι, θα ήθελα να σας πω ότι είναι ξεχωριστή χαρά μου και το εννοώ σήμερα εδώ σε αυτόν τον γνώριμο από παλιά χώρο για αυτή την τόσο σημαντική συνάντηση. Η Ελλάδα στο σημείο που βρίσκεται, δηλαδή στον πυρήνα μιας γενικευμένης κρίσης και ενός περιβάλλοντος ασφάλειας που εκτείνεται από την Τινησία μέχρι την Ουκρανία, έχει και λόγο και άποψη και πρέπει να αναλαμβάνει ρόλους, γίνοντας μπροστά με συγκεκριμένες προτάσεις και στρατηγικές. Αυτό το πρώτο διεθνές συμπόσιο του ΚΕΜΕΑ είναι μια σημαντική ευκαιρία για να αναδειχθεί ο κεντρικός στρατηγικός ρόλος αυτής της χώρας στο όνομα των μεγάλων προσπαθειών που καταβάλλονται στην Ευρώπη και όπου η Ελλάδα μπορεί να διαδραματίσει κεντρικό ρόλο. Οι καιροί το θέλησαν, όπως ελέγχθη πρωτήτερα, να μου ανατεθεί από την Ευρωπαϊκή Επιτροπή και από τον πρόεδρο Γιούνκερ ένα χαρτοφυλάκιο για το οποίο πρέπει να σας πω ότι όταν το ανέλαβα πριν από 5 χρόνια δεν μπορούσα να φανταστώ ότι σε 5 μήνες το μεταναστευτικό και η ασφάλεια θα ήσαν τα κορυφαία ζητήματα για την Ευρώπη αλλά για ολόκληρο τον κόσμο. Και όλο αυτό τον καιρό, ξεκινώντας σχεδόν από το μηδέν, γιατί η Ευρώπη δεν ήταν προετοιμασμένη για την αντιμετώπιση αυτών των ζητημάτων, καταφέραμε να κάνουμε βήματα μπροστά. Αλλά ακόμα δεν μπορούμε να πούμε ότι τα θέματα αυτά τελούν κάτω από απόλυτο έλεγχο. Αυτές τις αρχές λοιπόν σκέψεις, που και πάλι ευχαριστήσω και ευχηθώ καλή επιτυχία σε αυτές τις πρωτοβουλίες που έχετε αναλάβει, θα ήθελα να μου επιτρέψετε, απευθυνόμενος στον μεγάλο αριθμό ξένων προσκεκλημένων της σημερινής συνάντησης, να μιλήσω στα αγγλικά. Ladies and gentlemen, I said before that it is really an honor for me to be here today to open the first Athens Security Symposium. And I would like to congratulate the President and the Board of the Greek Center for Security Studies, in particular you, Mr. President, Professor Tsakonas, for this initiative, which could not have been more topical and more timely. The presence here today of politicians, diplomats, academies, international and regional organizations, representatives from EU agencies, and in presence of the director of the Office of the European Parliament in Athens, of law enforcement representatives, the military, as well as the private sector, promises a meaningful exchange of views. We all know that security is at the very top, not only of the European, but also of the global policy agenda. Along with migration, it is also among the top concerns of European citizens today. These are issues that touch the lives of our citizens on a daily basis. Greece has been in the eye of the storms brewing in our neighborhood. It has been at the forefront of old and new security threats, emanating from one of the most unstable regions in the world. In the year 2014, when I took over my duties as European Commissioner responsible for migration and security, but also for the fight against organized crime and drugs, few of us were prepared for the parallel crisis we were about to face in these four areas. While not necessarily connected, both issues, especially migration and security, are today putting in question the very fundamentals and cohesion of our European Union. of our unity. We had to learn hard lessons, to adapt the way we work at all levels, to stand next to our member states, such as Greece, and help them deal with the massive pressures they are facing on the ground in the most operational way possible. However, if anything has become clear over the past 2 years, it is that we can only manage these issues together with trust and unity. Why do I say this? Today's security environment is volatile and unpredictable. There are different factors that can create insecurity: regional conflicts, economic instability, sectarianism, violent extremism, but also poverty, demography, and climate change. What is common among these threats is that they do not stop at national borders. They do not stop there. Our member states have the primary responsibility for their security. But it is clear, and I have been saying this since the first day I became commissioner, that one single member state simply cannot address these multidimensional threats on its own. The security of one member state of the Union is the security of all. This is why security is at the heart of the European Union's primary mission: to create a Europe that protects. And this is why, for the past 2 years, we are working towards an effective and genuine security union, building on the foundations laid by the 2015 European Agenda on Security. Here, again, we go back to trust. The past 2 years, the experiences Europe has had with terrorism have been an eye-opener. The threat affects all of us equally. We all need to realize that it doesn't stop, as I said before, at our borders. And fragmentation makes us all vulnerable. And this is exactly the mentality change we have been trying to achieve. In good time, the building blocks of our security union should be the same for a defense union. External and internal threats are linked and should be dealt with collectively, and I will explain why. We are giving our member states the tools, the structures, and the resources to fight these threats better and together. And we have made real progress in this respect. Definitely, we are not where we were 3 years ago. In terms of enhancing security at our external borders, with the European Borders and Coast Guard and systematic checks of everyone crossing the border, in terms of improving information exchange through better and more connected information systems, in terms of restricting the means with which terrorists commit attacks, such as firearms and explosives. We have allocated funds to our member states to better protect their citizens in public spaces against low-cost, low-tech terrorism. We have strengthened our efforts to control money laundering and other financing sources of terrorism. We have reinforced the criminal justice legal framework against terrorism. All these actions, of course, do not change the fact that member states remain responsible for their national security. But which national security can we talk about when terrorists crisscross national borders to plan, coordinate, and execute their crimes. When the threat is transnational, our response can only be collective. Terrorism transcends our notion of the nation state. We need to respond in the same way. The deep state, if I can call it like this, resisting this natural evolution has to understand. We are only hurting our own interests by working in security silos, isolated. This is the logic of putting Europol at the very center of our collective operations. It was on one of my priorities from the very first moment I started my term as commissioner. And Europol today is not what it was 2.5 years ago. Its role is enhanced and its mandate is stronger. An agency we reinforced many times in resources and in expertise to provide all the support member states need to address these threats. With its own counter-terrorism center now, Europol guarantees 24/7 operational support to our member states. Of course, this is a fight that we cannot only fight on the ground or at our borders. As ISIS and Daesh loses territory on the ground, the battleground against terrorism increasingly moves to the Internet. The Internet is an echo chamber and a catalyst for amplifying the terrorist message for recruitment, disseminating knowledge, and providing a platform for secure communications. It is absolutely urgent and indispensable that we achieve a step change in how we fight terrorism on the Internet. In New York, at the United Nations General Assembly last September, we passed the message loud and clear. We have to stop terrorists misusing the Internet. Companies, governments, NGOs need to work together as one. Precisely for this purpose, since 2015, I set up a voluntary partnership with the Internet industry through the European Union Internet Forum, as we call it, to take terrorist content off the Internet. We are already removing a lot of terrorist content. I can tell you that at the beginning it was quite difficult because we have to admit that there is a sort of mistrust towards the public sector. But we established a good faith and trustful cooperation with the Internet providers. And right now, more than 90% of the terrorist material online is taken down, and we have addressed an invitation also for smaller companies to sign up, and they have started reporting positive. So now we cooperate with Facebook, with Google, Twitter, Microsoft, and many other big platforms. More and more, we cooperate very effectively with the Internet industry. But now it's time to take this work one step further. Next week in Brussels, the Internet Forum will meet again to redouble our efforts. We want to push Internet platforms to do more, to move towards more automation in fighting terrorism online, bringing, as I said before, more companies to our partnership and cooperate better with law enforcement authorities. The problem, of course, does not end with the Internet. Recent attacks are showing both the alarming speed and the scale at which some citizens are becoming, are getting radicalized. We clearly face a serious challenge which requires immediate and concerted action. Threats do not only materialize from the outside. Threats from inside are the most frequent, serious, and difficult to stop. Our recently set radicalization awareness network has served us well since the year 2015. It's now time to rethink how we can enhance its impact on the ground. The results it can bring in stopping our own citizens from taking up arms against us. And here, I will say it again, we cannot stop with security within our own borders. Our internal and our external security are a continuum. Ladies and gentlemen, Europe is not an island, and it will never become a fortress. Europe remains open, democratic, and hostable. And Europe is based on principles and values that we have to defend. The threats in our neighborhood materialize at our front door. This is why we have upgraded security and counter-terrorist cooperation with countries in the region of the Western Balkans and around the Mediterranean, such as Tunisia, Lebanon, Jordan, Egypt, and Turkey. On radicalization, firearms trafficking, information sharing on foreign terrorist fighters, cooperation with our neighbors can make a difference in how effectively we can respond. Again here, our operational agencies such as Europol can play an important role in enhancing security cooperation with third countries. Next week, we will propose to open negotiations with Algeria, Egypt, Israel, Jordan, Lebanon, Morocco, Tunisia, and Turkey to enable information exchanges between Europol and these countries on crime and terrorism. Europol is also key in delivering to law enforcement authorities in Europe important information from our military missions in Syria and in the wider Middle East. A fingerprint found in a terrorist safe house in Raqqa can lead to arrests of foreign terrorist fighters on European territory. After a lot of work and persistence on our side, we now have a liaison officer stationed in Jordan with Operation Gallant Phoenix. Europol is also the host of more than 20 American security officers to cooperate on terrorism, organized crime, migrant smuggling, drugs, and so forth. I want to close on this point. Cooperation with our international partners and global stakeholders, and especially the United States. This is a historical bond which we have a duty to nurture and to deepen. From a political point of view, this is one way for Europe to ensure a role which is commensurate to historical role in global affairs. I'm responsible on behalf of the European Union for a continuous EU-US dialogue on security. And it was just 15 days ago that I met again with the Homeland Security Secretary and the Attorney General of the United States. And our decision is a given now. We're going to continue our cooperation at all levels. With a clear strategic vision, we have to make sure that Europe has a seat at the table in the major security discussions of the day. I will give you one recent example. I'm sure you have read it in the newspapers. The United States banned laptops from countries in the Middle East. It was widely rumored that Europe was next. That is when I took the initiative to pursue a frank dialogue with our American partners. On the basis of trust and frank cooperation with my counterparts from the United States side, with Homeland Security Secretary John Kelly, who is now, as you know, the Chief of Staff of the White House, we acknowledged that the threat we face is common. We agreed on the need to raise the bar of aviation security globally by sharing and combining all the information we both had. We arrived to a 10-point action list of common measures on detection and risk mitigation in Europe and around the world. Global cooperation on global issues such as security can produce global solutions. Ladies and gentlemen, a lot has been done in the past years, but we are not naive. The threat from terrorism is not about to disappear anytime soon. Our neighborhood is likely to remain unstable. No country can or should deal with these challenges alone. This is the lesson we have learned. As I said in the beginning, organized crime, terrorism, and migration without amalgamating terrorists with migrants, they are all phenomena of our times that transcend borders. They do not recognize borders. So international cooperation is a must. And I believe, Mr. Chairman, this is one of the messages that this meeting today should extend to everybody: global cooperation. In unity, in a spirit of responsibility and trust, I want to be frank with you. This is what we lack at the level of international cooperation: trust. I said in the beginning, because the deep state still resists. Whether we want to admit or not, we live in a globalized world, starting from economy to terrorism. So we have to enhance and deepen international cooperation in order to defend our values, and most importantly, what mankind has achieved, especially after the Second World War. Safeguard and defend the European Union. Because I think you will agree with me that finally, as I was telling you before, it is not the economic crisis that has put at stake the European Union and unity. It is the migration crisis and the security crisis. So we have to enhance and deepen our cooperation, overcoming all these stereotypes of the past, and address these challenges in unity and trust. The threat is against all of us, and only collectively can we address it, with a strong security union protecting our citizens at home and a global security role for Europe and the world. I had been championing from the very beginning of my term as commissioner that it is the moment for Europe to set up a European information agency. I have to share with you that in the very beginning, when I said it, there were many reactions, not necessarily positive, from some member states. But in a short period of three years, they all realized, given all these dramatic events we have lived in Europe with the terrorist attacks in Paris, in Germany, in Spain, that it is absolutely necessary to start exchanging information and intelligence. And this can be done only if we set up a genuine security union. And the first step was done recently when President Juncker, in his State of the Union speech in Strasbourg, he embraced and endorsed my proposal, and we are moving towards the creation of a European agency unit. So, collectively, together, we can do more in providing our citizens with what is also one of their fundamental rights, safety. And security is the umbrella under which safety can be achieved for the citizens of our Union and for the citizens of the world. Thank you very much for your attention.